unexpected error occurred? The hell is that supposed to mean? It says streaming error, unexpected error occurred. But it's streaming, so I'll just pull it from the stream. So I'll take out these. No, I'm streaming on Twitch. We're streaming on Twitch right now, but we can have the conversation about this. I got the timer up top. You said you got most of the stuff open on your side. I see you. I'll probably take out this first minute. You know, most people aren't just going to jump in and join. I got to switch this anyway. I always forget to do that. Talk show and podcast. E3 convo. No, not even. JHVN. Podcast talk. E3. I mean, we could honestly stream this at the exact same time, too.
So it's showing you as offline, don't mind.
Your life. Yep. It takes a minute. Okay, cool. So I'll probably add out the first minute part of this. So interaction with the stream's cool, and it's going to go on YouTube as well. So a couple seconds when you turn back around. What is up, nerds? Welcome back. Though we have been gone for a while, we were both being hermits in our house. Welcome back to the JHVN podcast. JHVN or JHVN? Which one?
Haven.
JHVN.
It just sounds different.
Yeah, JHVN. Yeah. All right. Anyway, JHVN podcast. I think it's the fourth or fifth one. It's been a while. Last time that we chatted, we were talking about going to the BTS concert, and then that happened, and it changed my life. So,
I apologize, by the way. There's a Roomba.
Is it DJ Roomba?
Vuka, clean in your house.
Do your camera looks so much better than mine. I look like I haven't slept. Yeah, you look great.
Thank you.
What's up, Kronos? Yeah, so everyone, if you do not remember, it is me, Cloud, and that is
your boy, Good
JD. Yeah. Me and JD really haven't had an opportunity to sit down and chit chat with each other about the E3, and there were some pretty big announcements, some pretty big stuff. Unfortunately, I worked for most of it, and JD did a tremendous amount of more research for this than I did. So I'm gonna let Homeboy take the baton on this one, lead, and we're just gonna chit chat about some stuff. And we're live right now. We might try this out once in a while to stream it on Twitch. So it's kind of an off day, but we typically do our podcast on Sunday or Saturday. But we'll see how this goes streaming it. So anyway, JD, E-Tress, Electronic Entertainment, Espoon. 2019.
So I think the first thing that happened was the Microsoft conference, right? Couple things posted up in there, and I'm pulling this directly from websites, so it's not me that's like, yeah, I took notes or whatever. The first thing was Cyberpunk 2077. Did you see the trailer for that?
I did. Oh, so, yes, emotional trailer. Yes.
Yeah. So the homie Keanu Reeves is in there. So you know I'm hype.
I think it's pronounced John Wick.
Excuse me, sorry. My mistake. But you know, a lot of the stuff that's coming to play, it was actually really interesting seeing him come in, because it seemed like this shit was foreign to him. He's like, I'm on E3.
Yeah, it really felt like he looked really out of character. Like, you're a million-dollar actor. You've been in many roles. You're Neo. You are the Neo. You are the John Wick. And he's like, you're beautiful. Or what did he tell that guy? You're amazing.
He goes,
if no one thought Keanu Reeves entered into dad era, that him coming out and announcing himself in that game was him being a dad.
I enjoyed it. It was fun to see him come out of his shell. Like, you know how he like acts, like he's like, yeah, real excited to be here, it's a great time.
Yeah.
Like, you think it's a Mad TV skit or whatever, but that's legit him behind the scenes, so it's like cool to see. He was obviously super pumped. He's talking about Cyberpunk 2077, which honestly speaking, I'm not crazy hyped for, just because I'm a patient person. I like to see the games unfold. I like to wait till it's out and then go, yes, I will play.
Okay. You know?
I don't immediately just like to jump in and be like, oh my god. Double Fine Productions is joining Xbox, the guys that made Psychonauts. Cool.
So wait, I want to touch on Cyberpunk. So I was so gripped by the story, and I don't even know what's happening. Like, I don't know. And maybe it's because I also want to be artificially, like, embedded with machinery. The only thing I don't want to lose my tattoos. So I'm okay. Listen. I'm okay. Yeah, I'm okay with – I'll be the first in line to get a debit card implant. I can answer a phone call on my wrist. I will give my eyes – if I can get the Sharingans implanted, but like I can access databases. But the Cyberpunk, the trailer for it was so good. Like it was predictable that when the guy went in, he'd be double crossed when he got out. I don't know why though. The emotion on the face is what really gripped me. Like I was genuinely invested in that small, I don't even know who this guy is. You could see he had to steal a chip and then his friend or his buddy, best friend, brother, who somewhat gets shot in the stomach, and I was like, no, brother, no. And then Keanu saves him from the dump. Also, Alita, Battle Angel, please, anyone? They're just going to steal that story. She was also found in a dump.
I never saw that movie, actually.
It wasn't. I thought it was awesome. I thought it was amazing. But I'm also a big fan of, I'm a huge fan of female leading roles that can whoop AF. So, yeah. So, Double Fine. I don't know if you got more on that, but I actually never played Psychonauts. I only saw it run at AGDQ.
I mean, if James didn't stop sucking its dick, maybe I wouldn't know about it, but apparently he's like, it's the greatest thing ever, so I don't know.
Psychonauts 2 looks exactly the same as the first one, but maybe that's the style. I'm old school because I consider it to look like Cell Damage. Do you remember that game?
Cell Damage.
It's that racing car that is cell shaded. Like they took the name and ran with it. Cell Damage.
It's awesome.
It's the new wave.
Don't know too much about that. Actually, I don't even really follow Double Fine all that much. So whatever. Gears 5 dropping September 10th. I don't have an Xbox One.
Oh.
So, I mean...
You got a birthday coming up. You got a good friend.
Yeah, right? You get some gift cards. I don't know, man. It's like one of those things where I'm just like... It's not that I'm... So, I don't know if you've been following on Twitter. Raul Coley is actually one of the voices of the characters on Gears 5.
The same guy that goes to Funhouse all the time?
Yeah.
Oh, awesome. Didn't know that.
Eyes on me.
He's got a really good voice.
No, he does, right? She's fucking mental, you know, like, he's got that, you know.
He played Assassin's Creed or Dark Souls or something? It's like, just a witty commentary. It's just the accent. It's saying it with an accent.
God damn it. Yeah.
The Roomba here.
I'm at your door, JD.
Would you like some cleaning service, sir?
Can I supply you?
You said no? I'll walk myself in.
Yeah, right. I'll come back later. So, whatever.
Back later.
Good for them. Phantasy Star Online 2 is finally coming to the West on Xbox One and PC. I'll probably have it on PC. Free to play. My brother actually played he played on a proxy server, I believe, on this game. He's like, it's fucking great. So good for them dropping that.
So we have a lot of experience with Phantasy Star 1. A tremendous amount of experience. And the story I want to bring up to you, because this guy over here was set, like, he was the first indoctrination that I had to what it would be like to have a TI. If you play Phantasy Star Online with JD and you're like, all right, great, what's the thing that the game gives you, and you go through a tutorial, it says use your mag. Your mag boosts your attack, it helps you, it gives you stat. Use it. Feed it what it wants. Each mag is different. Mag's like a little helper buddy. It's like Navi from or Claptrap. Like, it's just a character that helps you out through the game. But you can feed it and it buffs you. JD says, first 10 levels, you ain't using it. You need to showcase your skill set. Let's go. So that's always stuck with me since then. But
better than your mag.
Did PSO2 have mags? Was that consistent?
I don't know. I'd have to talk to
him. It seems really cool. So the concept behind it seems awesome.
It's faster, dude. It's way faster.
Yeah. The combat for the large sword, those three hits, took a while for me to like get back in the zone. I think the idea behind it's really cool. I think the wave, the downloads will be massive, but honestly, I don't foresee. But then again, WoW Vanilla's coming out, and everyone's up in arms about that, and that's, you know, better than it's going to be better than WoW, but that's a whole nother one.
Interesting beast. Definitely talk to Eric about that. Elden Ring is dropping. Hidetaka Miyazaki and George R. R. Martin are dropping a collaboration, which I'm pretty excited
to tell see. Me you didn't think that was Lord of the Rings, and it's from software, dude. Like, what do you, it's Lord of the Rings meets if you die, you die.
You know, if it's not Bloodborne, I'm sorry, I'm just being honest. If it's not Bloodborne, it's not something that's really gonna hype me up. I'm obviously gonna buy this game because it's Hidetaka Miyazaki and it's George R. R. Martin. So yeah, I'm gonna buy it. You don't even have to show me gameplay and you know I'm gonna buy it. But where's Bloodborne?
That's all I can say, no, man. I agree. Bloodborne 2. I just think even when Sekiro got announced the first time, like, everyone was like, what is this? Like,
yeah.
Tell me, what is this?
Shadows Die Twice, Tenchu?
No, yeah, to Wrath of Heaven. But now this time coming around, we're looking at, it looks just like when they were making The Ring. And it's completely different. I know it's separate. I know Lord of the Rings is completely separate from Martin. But the sense that I get from it, I'm getting that blacksmith-like mentality. That there's this one item that rules, just like the flame ruled, or the light. I'm seeing, I don't know. I'm getting that very that sense of Demon Souls. Like, you loaded up the game and you had no idea what was happening. So I'm excited.
Yeah. Time will tell. We got to see more on that. But luckily, FromSoft is pretty good about, we announced it, we're showing gameplay a couple months later, you know.
Yeah.
So we'll probably see something, you know, towards the end of this year. Something really definitive towards the end of this year. Battletoads is obviously coming back. 2D, it's a 2D fighter, 3-player with couch co-op. So that sounds like that's a drunken stream in the making.
I think couch co-op's cool because that gives off that
Scott Pilgrim.
Thank you. You took the words right out of my mouth, man. But also, Double Dragon had a re-release that everyone was excited for, and then that was
Not the best.
Again, it's the novelty. It's the idea of it. The idea that it exists. You know what I mean? Like, oh, Battletoads is coming back. That's awesome. Okay, it's here. All right. Yeah. Also, right below is the Dark Souls game, or that we think is going to be the Dark Souls game. It's got a damn ring with a circle in it, with another hand. That's, like, yes. I don't know.
Yeah. Obviously, Dragon Ball Z Kakarot was announced, of course. That is looking at being a RPG, a true RPG. I saw the gameplay on it. It's pretty interesting. Looks like it plays like Budokai, and not
Tekkaichi.
Yeah, just plays like normal Budokai, and when you're fighting people. But other than that, it's like a huge free roam area, and you get like, yeah, it's RPG elements. So I really don't have much to say about that. I really don't want to talk about it too much, because the other thing that's interesting and I think you'll be excited for is Outer Worlds. It's RPG by Obsidian. It's looking like the next Fallout, though, based upon what's going on it, you know, which is interesting.
The Outer World looked really cool. It definitely gave off... like, everyone knew it was Outer World before it came out, or before it got the name got officially put on it. But unfortunately, I'm not. Fallout 76 is actually free this week.
So well, they had an expansion that got dropped. So
that's
or not expansion. It was something like that.
It's yeah, something it like yeah. Fallout 76, personally, I defended it as long as I could. After what the company did, it wasn't so hot with me. But on top of that, the gameplay just wasn't. I didn't get that. I sometimes games need to stay a single player experience. when I play Fallout, I get that I'm supposed to be with all these other Wastelanders, but if you want to make a real Fallout 76, then make it an MMO. Anyway, going back to Outer World, I love a shooter, which, you know, Borderlands has that shooter looter game with those RPG elements, and you know, I look back at Fallout 1 and being able to do my strength, how smart you were dictated how you talked in your dialogue. If you were a klutz, if you were level 1, you would talk literally like, me look for Chip, Chip give water. If you were level 10, it was like, I'm looking for Chip number 7536B5, blah, blah, blah. You know what I mean? Yeah. And now you look at Fallout 76 and it's, I need another settlement. And I know that's Fallout 4, but same kind of concept. Another
settlement and need your help. That kind of sucks.
Yeah.
What else? I'm going to skip over a couple of things because, man. Jedi Fallen Order.
Oh my gosh. Force Whitaker? I had no idea he was going to be in the game.
I was a little surprised. I was like, all right. I mean, run it. Fine. Whatever. But, you know, time will tell how it's going to look. I don't really want to talk about too much on that. What I want to hear was what was actually shown a little bit earlier down below was the Blair Witch game. How excited are you for that?
So if the Blair Witch game looked exactly like Alan Wake, so I thought it was going to be Alan Wake 2. I was a fan of Alan Wake. I played the Xbox 360 one. That was one of the few horror games that I remember playing, thousanding it or platinuming it, whatever the term is. Because I wanted to, I enjoyed the unsettling feeling. Your weapon was a flashlight. You had a gun, but the real weapon was the flashlight. I don't know what it is about 2019, but I've been such a big fan of horror games right now. I've streamed.
Yeah, I noticed.
Yeah, so I love first person psychological thrillers. You know, the beginning of the trailer shows the guy running after his dog into a weeded bush, and then, but turns out as the camera pans out, it's a Blair Witch field, and the Blair Witch was, you know, to some people a documentary. So if it's a horror game, I'm completely down. I still haven't played Layers of Fear 2, but if a horror game's coming out that's new, I'm absolutely all for that. But what about you, man?
I don't know what to make of it, man. To be honest,
because you're not a horror game guy.
I wouldn't say that. It's within reason for me. I actually like the blend of action and horror. Dead Space 2 is probably one of my favorite horror games because I think the blend was done so well on it. Dead Space 1, I sort of had to like muscle my way to beat, which is like, all right, I'm done, you know. But Dead Space 2, I was freaking hooked at that point. Mm-hmm. I feel the same thing would happen with me on Evil Within and Evil Within 2. I've never played the games. I've played Evil Within 1. I did the opening area. That's it. It's not that I can't play horror games or that I don't want to. I've played 7, I played 2, Resident Evil. I haven't played any of the Silent Hills, but like I can, and I've played Outlast. I don't know, man. It's I'd have to like play them again, I think. And then I can like start to, you know, get a handle on it and whatnot. One of the things that I did want to mention obviously was the I believe it's the Xbox Scorpio launching with Halo. Project Scarlet.
Scarlet, yeah. Scorpio?
It's late. Project Scarlet with Halo, which we just saw a little bit of down below. I don't want to talk too much about specs and things like that. I want to wait until a lot of this stuff gets released before we can actually start talking about
I think that they put the most emphasis on was the loading times, yeah?
That was the same thing with what's it called? There was a leaked PlayStation 5 video or whatever they're going to call it that did the exact same thing.
Do you mind doing the Castlevania theme? I got some people in the chat that want to. Wait, do the. Oh, man.
I got people trying to sleep in the other room.
Well, you got DJ Rumor making a beat.
DJ Rumor. Hey, DJ. Bring you the 80s, 90s, and the 2000s.
Oh, man.
I intend to play that game again. I got a grudge match against Bloodlines. I'll get to it. Anyway, interesting stuff. They sort of put their foot down as far as to, we're dropping this console. Holiday 2020. So that has, if Sony is not ready, that has forced Sony's hand. If they don't drop their console the same year, they're in trouble. So let's see what happens.
Maybe I missed it and I didn't pay attention to it at all. Why isn't Sony there?
They bowed out. Sony bowed out. Technically,
Xbox bringing that out.
Xbox was across the street, actually. It's all fucking weird, dude. A lot of it's fucking weird. A lot of them are like, hey, I'm too good for E3, is what it boiled down to. I think the best resource you can utilize is the, I don't know if you follow Inside Gaming on YouTube. They talk a great deal about it, about what's going on with really a lot of gaming stuff. I'd highly recommend anyone who's not subscribed to check them out, because it's the same guys from Funhouse, but they're not coming at it with a bias. They're coming at it, this is what's happening. Hey, here's some research that we did in regards to it. It's got all your favorite people, blah, blah, blah. So I'd recommend checking out a video on that. They discuss it more in detail than I ever could. But long story short, yeah, they just said, no, not this year. They're doing something else. The main reason why they said it is because, according to Inside Gaming, they're not able to talk upon holiday specific, which is the best time to buy games, right? Holidays, by holiday season, meaning Christmas, Thanksgiving, you know, that sort of time frame. they can't talk to those things because it's too late in the year. So they do their own event, which is interesting. So we'll see. Yeah. Anyway, so that's all for Microsoft. Don't want to talk about that one too much. Let's talk Bethesda. Bethesda, if I'm being honest, didn't really have anything too crazy. However, one of the coolest things about the Bethesda show, have you heard about that on YouTube?
No.
So you should probably watch it. It's like a minute long here. I'll put it on the what's it called? Discord. This girl has become an internet meme
overnight
because of how she has interacted. So it's this girl who, her name is Ikumi Nakamura. She is the director, or the creative director for Ghostwire Tokyo. Right, it's a new game coming out by Bethesda. I don't know what it was, but she's like, I'm going to go out there and I'm going to capture everyone's souls with just the way I behave. And it's like many moons ago when we had that the guy that came on talking about For Honor, and you could tell he was passionate.
Oh, yeah.
It's the exact same thing.
Exact same energy.
Except she's Japanese, so she's speaking broken English. So, you know, it's like, I'll give it the dub. It's cute. It's cute.
Yeah. Well, hey man, I want that. That's the kind of energy you need, man. If you're because of this one woman's intuition to give it her best shot for the game that she loved, that she worked on, that she's passionate for, that she's excited, that she wants to share with people. That's the kind of energy that you need to have. I don't even know what Ghostwire was. I missed it. But because of you and watching this chick right now, I've seen her do 13 different hand movements. I do the exact same thing. Baby girl gets a mad dub from you, boy. And I mean this boy.
Yeah, man. She's just happy. She's like, bring it on. That's because she's like, hey, I'll try and speak English. And then she waited for a second and people started cheering her. She's like, yeah, come on, bring it. And I was like, okay. She cocky.
I like it, man. I like it.
She's like, it's spooky. I was like, oh my God. So that's a lot awesome. Of people thought she was like super cool. And she might have just like solidified people are going to be interested in Ghostwire Tokyo. Not too much really talked about. It's just action adventure. People disappearing from Tokyo. gotta figure out what the fuck's going on. Deathloop.
Oh my gosh. Okay, so I saw 10 seconds before you go any further. So I saw, I was watching, shout outs to Clay Cuzzolt, fellow, he's the big swole daddy of FFBE, soon to be FFBE too, and playing a lot of Epic 7. But I was in a stream and I just missed that. I saw the back end of that and it looked really, really cool. So what I saw when I came in was, it was the same man, the same girl, but it was like the room shifted. Like when someone left, I can't remember exactly, but when it shifted, it was another story, or it continued it. So the crazy part to me is I'm viewing that it's a relationship between two people, or maybe even a third, and each time you make a decision, like maybe you lift a coffee cup and move it to this side of the table, it changes the dynamic. So I haven't watched the trailer since, because I wanted to watch the trailer, and then we talked about making a podcast, so I wanted to have first opinions. I won't lie though, I did watch Poppin' and Send One a few times, but I mean, go ahead and get out of here, okay? And I got like 8 tattoos of the guy. But anyway, so does it have a description of it? I would love to know what it is.
As this website puts it, mind-bending story, quotations. It's an emphasis on level design, of course. It'll revolve around playing the way that you want to play. Made from the same guys that made Dishonored. It's about time loops, essentially. So we don't know for sure. We're in same vibe I'm getting. Gotta wait to see how it plays out before I start getting hyped on stuff like that. Moving forward, Doom Eternal out November 22nd.
Oh man, that OST, boys, that's all I want to see.
The OST is of course great.
OST has to be Mick Gordon. If it's not, I don't know what I'm going to think.
I would think. There's no one that goes as heavy as he does, so.
Which makes the most sense. A lot of people don't know, he also did the Killer Instinct, the revamp, the remake on the Xbox One. He did the entire OST for that as well, so.
He did the, I don't think he did season 3. He did seasons 1 and 2.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, I'm not sure if 3.
Yeah, because season 3 just fell off. But, like, season 2, they made sure to get in, you know, what's his name? What's your character? Incineroar? His fucking name
Cinder.
Sure,
Incineroar would be Saberwolf and Cinder together. His name is Cinder. I do not want to be you today.
Shut up.
That's exactly what he says.
All it is it's a psycho.
I do not want to, dude. How badass do you gotta be to get in a fight and go, I do not want to be you today?
The greatest contribution that he has brought has been the Shadow Jago theme. By all means, in my opinion, is the best.
Agree to disagree. Both are great tracks, but Cinder's theme is the best theme. That or Spinal, Palamos.
Spinal's good.
Spinal's
good. But I think we're coming into a reoccurring theme. All that's Mick Gordon. So
truly, yeah,
man knows what he's doing. Let's see what he does with Doom Eternal. A lot of the gameplay we're seeing outside of the shoulder cannon, some developments with melee weapons and whatnot, is similar, but it's not like it's a bad thing. If it ain't broke, don't fix it kind of mentality.
Mm-hmm.
So time will tell. We got to wait till we get our hands on it November 22nd. I wish I could play it on PC. I'll probably be playing it on console.
I might have missed it. What game was this?
Doom Eternal.
Oh, yeah. Yes. Yeah. I said this on stream. I honestly, truly believe Doom Eternal and every other Doom game, I don't know what the online is going to be like. I really feel like the Quake Doom age of constant loading and playing is not here. I think most people, including myself, are going to rent the game, enjoy it for the weekend, the week maybe. But then after that,
I don't know, man. If it's good, I might buy it. I've never beat the difficulty on Doom. You die once, you restart the game. Difficulty.
Oh, man, that's... But people are mad about Sekiro. Anyway.
obviously, we talked about it, but Fallout's getting a new update that's going to add NPCs, a couple of other things. Bethesda apparently was very well aware, as well as they should be, of the rough launch difficulties when the game came out. So they're trying to adhere to that. I have no doubt Bethesda's going to fix what they messed up. But I think it's, I think what a lot of people are coming down to, and I could be wrong about this because, you know, gamers are fucking dumb sometimes where they're like, let me get upset about something. Mm-hmm. Not to say that this isn't something they shouldn't get upset about, but more of knee-jerk reactions. I think they're going to fix this game.
76?
Yeah, I think it's going to take some time, but yeah, they're absolutely going to fix the game. It's just going to be to that point where it's like, there are, you're going to have those guys who are like, I've been there since the start, since I fell through the floor. And then there's going to be those other guys that are like, yeah, I started playing when I realized the game was fixed.
Yeah.
You know, so, hey, you know, it's each own, who cares, whatever.
What's up, Pomatron?
Let's see, Elder Scrolls Blades. I think I mentioned that to you earlier. I was like, hey, it's a...
The mobile?
Yeah, it's mobile, but it's coming to Switch as well. It's going to have... It's going to be free to play, cross play, and cross progression. So something interesting to keep in mind with that. So I'd like to see that for, and I'm really not trying to win any points with the audience, but like for Brave Exvius or something like that, where it's a cross play situation where you can play on your Switch. Not saying you can't, but at the same time, man, if I'm playing on my Switch, it shit's a whole lot easier for me to, you know, play through instead of using my phone, having to have it next to a charger, things like that. The Switch is just geared for mobile play.
Sure, yeah. It can even... You are testament to that. JD unlocked like two other Smash characters.
Two?
he unlocked Smash while we were out and about doing daily business.
Doing some fun.
Farmer, what positive things have you heard about 76? And look, listen, Kronos, if anything, I'm the least Lego excited Forza person Horizon for Lego Forza Horizon. Okay, no, at no point. No. The closest I'll get to that is Lego Batman. JD is the best podcaster, PogChamp. I co-signed that too. Yeah, this is I'm your boy JD and this is Declan. So thanks for those compliments, guys. So
moving on.
Yep.
They still have Elder Scrolls 6 that is being looked like they're talking about, and then obviously Starfield. A lot of people are upset that Starfield wasn't shown off or anything like that. I don't know too much about Starfield.
Me either.
Not gonna lie, it's just an RPG from Bethesda. It's a new IP. I haven't followed it too much, but I guess some people are upset because they wanted to see something on it. Whatever. You know, like. It's like putting something in the oven, let it cook. You know, if it's not showing up this time around, it's like the same thing. I think Bethesda blew their load too early when they showed it off Elder Scrolls 6, because you didn't show it off this week or this time around. So why show? Hey, by the way, we're developing it. Just let it happen.
Was that game leaked before? Not leaked, but was information in trailers information passed out prior?
There was a teaser. Last year.
Last year?
Yeah, it really shouldn't have been something to happen.
It's a yikes for me, dog.
Yeah. Outside of that, id Software, Commander Keen is coming back. It's a free-to-play mobile modern take on a side-scroller shooter. So it's the great-grandchildren of B.J. Blazkowicz.
Oh, jeez, really?
Yeah.
Wolfenstein?
Yeah, Tom. We'll see. And then, of course, Rage is getting an expansion.
So really quick. So let me ask you a question as an individual that does not play mobile games, right? You do not play mobile games.
Nah.
So do you feel from a standpoint of AAA titles, right? So you play Final Fantasy XIV. That's your bread and butter. AAA titles, you've beaten, you know, between the both of us, we've beaten every game on planet Earth, right? So from that perspective, do you think that two questions for you. One, kind of a hot topic. Do you think that mobile games are video games? And two, do you think that mobile games are becoming like, so again, you don't play mobile games. So Diablo Eternal, Elder Scrolls Blades, those mobile games could have became Elder Scrolls Skyrim. Two,
yeah.
That could have became, a number of things. So my question to you is, do you think it's, again, do you think mobile games are video games? And two, do you think the market's becoming oversaturated? What could be AAA titles are now just becoming cash grabs. Because, yeah, gacha games are just that. Every week, a new banner's out, man. Every 2 weeks, I want to get this character. She's awesome. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, anyway, two questions, your opinion.
Is this about Dr. Disrespect?
First, shout-outs to not Dr. Disrespect, because my formulated opinion is complete opposite of his. But I do want to hear it from someone. You know me as a mobile streamer. You know me as your friend, and I, you know.
So you're putting the pressure on me.
100%. But you're, again, everyone's entitled to their opinion, everyone's perspective. I mean, you know, what... You know, people have opinions on, I'm specifically at calling him out, but he has a great character that he portrays, but outside of that, he'd never, shows who he is. So I just think that dynamic of you're one person here, then another person there kind of sucks. Like, as a streamer, I myself, just because I, you know, what about the people that draw, what are people that make cosplays, body paint, chit chat, talk shows, podcasts, they play, crappy Flash games with their communities. I just think everyone's classification for what is, there's no grand scheme. Would you call a D&D player a gamer? Is it because it's not electronic? Anyway, I'm getting off into my own rant. So,
on Twitter, I know Corey Balrog, which is the lead designer for God of War, and then Boogie had talked about it. I disagree with both of them. I don't think all mobile gaming is gaming. I think it's dependent on your investment. I think it's on your dependent to have a capacity of investment for a game like Brave Exvius or Epic 7. I think it is. Because there's a lot of shit that's going on. There's not just, all right, shoot this bird into these fucking pigs kind of a thing. You know, it's not just a time waster. It's something that you actually put time and effort in. You care about the shit that happens. And the best way I could say is investment, for lack of a better term. But I feel like there's more at play with those games. So, like, that's why I never, like, diss you or anything like that, and I mean obviously we're friends, but I mean, yeah, even if I wasn't, you know, and like if I hop in your stream, I'm just going, hey, what happened?
Yeah,
or what is this?
You're engaging
more
for
than
sure.
I'm going like, hey, I'm here, pay attention to me that I'm here, you know. There's a side to it. So I think it really depends on what you're looking at. I don't think every single mobile game, I don't think Flappy Bird makes you a gamer. I'm gonna be honest with you. I'm sorry. If I'm investing in a game that really doesn't have any development to it, I think the basis of a game is to be transformative. And in that regard, a game like Brave Exvius can be, because it requires you to develop strategies or skills to accomplish a task, more so than a game like Flappy Bird, where it's like hit it at this, or not Flappy Bird, Angry Birds, where it says hit it at this angle.
Yeah,
you know, and stuff like that. So no, it's hard to answer that question.
No, I think you rode the delicate balance. I agree. A child that picks up, it's all about perspective. Like you said, in your opinion, playing Flappy Bird or Angry Birds necessarily doesn't require the skill set, the time, the commitment, the investment. To take that skill set, move it somewhere else, or to necessarily grow from it. You know, there might be a Flappy Bird Championship on PenguinClub.com. It's not like you're gonna go to Evo. but in the exact same cube, right? In the exact same like mindset. The other side of the mirror is like, you know what? How open do you? Like I said, I'm a all gamers for gamers kind of concept. Like, obviously, I would call out a poser that was like, yo, dude, I play games, bro. I played Final Fantasy XI. My favorite character was Squall. Like, okay, dude, clearly you don't know what you're talking about. Yeah, I played mobile games. I played Battletoads back in the day. I'm a gamer. Look, dude, if you want to claim that title, I'm not going to force it. I just think for people that don't play mobile games or don't invest time or, you know, like, again, invest in them, when they look at these AAA companies, Square Enix, Bethesda, are putting all of their cookies to mobile gaming. I personally believe that it's slowly becoming a saturated market with AAA titles. Final Fantasy 15: A Realm Reborn is one of the highly grossed games.
I've never heard of that game. I only know Final Fantasy 14.
Oh, no, no. Oh, did I say Realm Reborn?
You said 15 of Realm Reborn. I was like,
my
damn.
Bad. A New Empire. That's what it was. A New
you
Empire.
You already played the event?
Anyway, we're getting sidetracked, but I'm glad you answered that. And like I said, that it was a very political answer, but I agree with what you said. To answer
Eric's thing, or Farmatron, I should say, I did catch him playing Pokemon Go on two different phones. Passed out on the couch, so
shaking them to open the eggs.
It takes your soul. I'm telling you, man.
I play a VR horror game with a pogo on it.
He's just like, but nah.
All right, a homie. E3,
Ubisoft. So Ubisoft, Watch Dogs Legion. The biggest thing that they're talking about with Watch Dogs Legion is APCs. Concept is all playable characters. The intent is that Legion is the basis that, you know, we are Legion, we are many, right? They're taking a note, as far as we know, from Anonymous, you know, the actual real-life hacking group, that is pretty much stating we are pulling, you know, inspiration from them and stating that every one of these people in the world could be a potential hacker for DedSec, right? DedSec's the leading hacker group in Watch Dogs, and pretty much the game is about finding the guy with the right skills for the right job. But also, even if you don't, it augments the gameplay. So, like, let's just say I go into an area that's like a crazy shootout area, but I'm playing as this old lady who has skilled pyrotechnics. You know, now I'm blowing that fucking place up, is really their intent. So it's interesting. I respect it from a design standpoint. The game it was leaked obviously before launch, but it's also been pushed
marketing
back because of the difficulty of getting that done. It's going to be out March 6th, so we'll see.
You picked that date,
dude. There's so many fucking
everything's
coming out.
Why did you pick March 6th? So really quick, so I never beat Watch Dogs 2. I did not beat Watch Dogs 1. I'm gonna call myself out, but I almost beat it. I don't know why I stopped. Played Watch Dogs 2 for a little bit. So is the scale on Watch Dogs 3 global? So because the first two were almost based in the same area, the story archetype was like one city. But
two's in San Francisco, one is in, I believe, Chicago, three is in London.
So it's not I thought they were gonna, like, again, the stage was getting bigger. It was getting more grand.
Dude, honestly, it might be. What I saw, like, gameplay wise, it didn't make it seem like there was a shit ton of, like, graphical overhaul. Maybe I'm wrong. Right, I gotta look at it again, but I definitely think the world is bigger, much bigger. You have to account for all these people, dude.
I understand. I just think, again, from my perspective, having the story go like, I would just watch Kingsman, the second one, and it's starting to, it opens the world, right? It went from welcome to London, we lost some tea with this bullet. Cause I'm a Kingsman, right? That it went from that to, all right, I'm a statesman. My name is Channing Tatum. Yeehaw!
That is not.
I use the same accent for both states. I kind of drooled right there too. This is getting absolutely ruined. So on top of it, the scale got grand. The stage was set. It was bigger. So I pictured Watch Dogs getting much larger. But again, you know, oh man, I'm such a, I don't know why, but 2019, 2020 is going to be such a single player experience for me. Because whenever we get to, obviously, Square Enix, we'll talk in detail, but because that was the best one. What else we got?
So outside of Ubisoft's Watch Dogs, which is obviously their one, they pretty much sandwiched their presentation, right? So Gods and Monsters, didn't really see too much about it. Mythical Creatures, storybook adventure about a forgotten hero on a quest to save Greek gods. okay, graphic or art design doesn't really interest me. We'll see. You play is apparently U Play Plus is its own subscription. $15 a month gets you access to over 100 Ubisoft games like Watch Dogs, Legion, apparently.
On release date,
it'll launch September 3rd. This includes other games from the past. So your first Watch Dogs, your Splinter Cells, your first Assassin's Creed, things of that nature will be playable.
Real quick, do you know if the Xbox Game Pass, which is the same price that offers multiple platform, does that also include Ubisoft games? Or it no?
Might, to be honest, you might cross some streams here. So I'd say before you invest in any gaming subscription, because the Xbox Live Game Pass has updated to expand to the PC, and then is also including a broad spectrum of games, especially newer games that are coming out, you need to be a conscious and educated consumer when you're getting this stuff. So don't just go out and buy it. Do some research on it beforehand.
I wonder, you spent $15 for just Ubisoft or $15 for some Ubisoft and everything else?
Just Ubisoft.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah. I mean, hey, I like Ubisoft. I don't have a problem with them. Some people do. I don't. But in playing The Division 2 with Spencer, he very much said to me, they made that game with the intent of it being an Ubisoft game. Didn't know what he meant at first, but as we talked about it more, it made more sense to me. So just be mindful of that. If you're sipping the juice from Ubisoft, by all means, keep going. But if you're undecided, spending $15 a month, I'd probably get 15 a month and then cancel my subscription as soon as I paid, just to test it out to see if I'm even interested in the games that they have to offer. Just something to keep in mind.
Yeah.
smart consumer, of course. It'll also be playable in 2020 on Google Stadia, so it'll be a feature on them. Obviously, Google Stadia is trying to really change the way gaming is done. I'm not going to talk about this game because it's just whatever. Rainbow Six Quarantine, three-player tactical versus player versus enemy co-op game coming out in early 2020. Looks similar to a suspenseful, possibly horror game. So we'll see. Not too much on that.
Tactical, a three-person tactical horror game would be. I think so. We didn't chat. We chatted a little bit about the horror part. I think I'm opposite. I don't want action horror. I want psychological horror.
Yeah,
I like Resident Evil 4. Resident Evil 7 was more of a horror game than it was a tactical action game. So for this new Rainbow Six to be a horror wouldn't entice me to play it.
They said it looks like a horror game. Mm-hmm. It could just be the first trailer, you know.
Yeah.
There's going to be a new mobile game called Tom Clancy's Elite Squad. Which has Sam Fisher in it, and
oversaturation, man. Again, I'm not saying it is, but the term is going to get thrown out a lot. Again, why is it now? You know, you look at Japanese or Korean mobile games, like they're huge, man. Even if they're not gacha, even if they're free to play, even if they're $2 a download and you get unlimited content in it, it is such a viable market. Skins were the first reason for that. And now it's just the convenience factor, man. You know how easy it is to press that purchase button and not realize how much money you have in your bank account till your bank calls you and says,
fuck you.
A little suspicious really here, bud. It's all good. I need Randy. Yeah,
I mean, yeah, it is what it is. We'll see. Division's getting a update. DC Outskirts Expedition kicks off July in general, I'm sorry, with episode 1 6 on that. Assassin's Creed's getting a story creator and discovery tour modes. Assassin's Creed Odyssey, I should be more specific. it's an alright game. After beating it, I realized that game doesn't know how to pace itself. So I think that's its probably biggest problem, but story creator might be interesting.
Story creator is unique. I know there's games like RPG Maker that exist that really don't get enough creators pushing out, hey, try this out. So maybe a bigger, because I don't even know who makes RPG Maker, I'll be honest with you. I don't know if it's Squeenix or what other JRPG company.
Who made Persona 5?
Atlas?
Was it Netflix? I think it was. Or did they publish it?
I've played Shin Megami Tensei Nocturne. That's it. Just because DMC2 Cloud was in it. I rest my... That's all the info I got. What's up, Sienna? What else, man? We need to get to Squeenix. I keep flexing my chest.
It was developed and published by Atlas to Japan and North America. The PAL version was Deep Silver, and then also by Sony. So, good for them. So let me end the rest of these. So, Rainbow Six Siege is getting a new season, Operation Phantom Sight. I've seen some of the ads on it. Interesting stuff. I've never played the game. For Honor is getting a limited time event called Shadows of Hidokiri. It's available this week.
Great pronunciation.
Arigato. Adventure Time is crossing over Brawlhalla. Jake Finn and Princess Bubblegum will be added to the game. Oh. Never played Brawlhalla, but I've seen it a couple times. It's going to be a side tourney at Evo, so, you know, good for them. Rob McElhenney from Always Sunny in Philadelphia is creating a new TV show that him and Charlie Day are putting together with Ubisoft. It's for Apple TV specifically, so I guess the streaming service. It's about game development. The last time that happened, I think, was Grandma's Boy. You know how they fucked that up, so we'll see. And then last but not least, good old John Bernthal showed up for Ghost Recon Breakpoint, a game that I am gonna get.
Oh,
drops October 4th.
Okay.
And John Bernthal plays the villain in it. It happens right after Wildlands. So it's. All right, they're being silly from what I'm reading here. Anyway, John Bernthal came on stage and brought his fucking dog because no one told him that he shouldn't. He was like, this is my dog. Anyway, let's talk about this.
Yeah, yeah. Dude. Hey, if you bring a dog to work with you, man, I immediately feed off that energy.
Right. Yeah, dog, tell me more.
Tell me more, so, dog.
Obviously very hype about that. I'm really interested in that game. So we'll see. Let's move on. Square Enix.
Oh, what? What happened to Square Enix, JD?
Let's work backwards. First is the Avengers.
Yeah, we got it. What about the end?
Avengers is arriving May 15th, 2020. From what it looks like here is... there is a intent to make the game very co-op oriented between the Avengers that you play, dibs on Iron Man. I mean, it should come without saying, but I'm who's definitely going to pick this game up just because I want to support Square, but also I just want to be able to play the game and as Iron Man, you know, work together with some homies. Granted, he's probably going to be like one of the top picks, you know, so for it sure. Sucks.
He is the MCU. MCU. Without him, it'd crumble.
Yeah, Final Fantasy VIII getting remastered. Good for them.
So, wait, backpedal real quick. So, Avengers. Yeah. Do you agree that since we've seen Chris Hemsworth, Chris Evans, Robert Downey Jr., Mark Ruffalo, these people, these iconic people, Scarlett Johansson, these iconic people in these iconic roles for so many years.
You're going to talk about how they look.
Here's my theory. Hear me out. Hey, Lich, man, thanks for that raid. I appreciate that, dude. Thank you very much, man. Sorry there's no notifications on. So the Avengers have a look to them that we've seen in motion, right? We've seen it in motion. We're so excited for it. When they don't translate to a game, we immediately, most of us, go, they look weird. But if you are a comic book reader and then you see the game, it's an easier transition. So I think they look weird, but I think it's because I have prolonged my senses to never reading a comic book about the MCU or about Marvel in so many years that when I look at them, I'm like, damn, it just doesn't – I don't get – like when I saw Captain, I was like, okay, clearly he's the he's with Hydra, clearly.
Well, I mean, like Thanso said, yeah, they can't pay them enough to use their faces. It's really – what it boils down to at the end of the day is, yeah, they're not going to use the likenesses of these characters because for all intents and purposes, we could be looking at an extended universe for the game.
But aren't they coming out with another Ultimate Alliance as well? So
they are. Yeah, on Switch.
It's about to be couch co-op. 2020 is going to be couch co-op year. Truly.
Yeah, I mean, truly. That's its own discussion, and we can have that discussion later. But with all that stuff in mind, I don't really care about how the characters look. Again, I want to see the gameplay. I want to see how this stuff sort of plays out. So from what it looks like from the cinematics, they're trying to enforce making a solid story by providing good, like they're providing the freaking best friends VA here. You got Nolan North and Troy Baker here, so they're already best friends, so you can putting them into their own title, or you know, obviously with these other actors. I apologize, I don't know their names, the other actors' names. Yeah. The actors and actress names. But at the same time, I'm also excited for what's going to happen. From what it looks like is they want to support this for a couple of years and add more guys into it. So it looks like it ended with Ant-Man being shown off. But a lot of people are going, hey, where's Hawkeye? Hawkeye is probably the next guy. Then we might see Black Panther. We could see Spider-Man. All that stuff would be interesting.
Could you? Because are we talking Square Enix now? From an individual that plays a mobile game that I barely understand. But like we talked about in a previous podcast about the idea between FFBE is the assets are owned. There's Gumi, there's Alim, but then there's Square Enix. Square Enix has the rights to some characters, if not almost all, in Kingdom Hearts, but they can't do anything with the Disney characters. That being said, they have the rights on the name Keyblade Master. So in Brave Exvius, Sora's name, his job title is Boy. Because they can't call him Keyblade Master, because that's TM. So I'm worried that Spider-Man is specifically, like, we won't see him. I don't know why Hawkeye wouldn't be shown. But again,
well, I mean, if they don't do Spider-Man, they can do Wolverine. They own X-Men.
Again, so I hate to be that guy. It's not Hugh Jackman.
It's but not.
Anyway, yeah,
but yeah. It's one of those things where it's just like, all right, it's coming. I think people should be more hopeful than, you know, upset about it. So, you know, we'll see. obviously, Saga, Romancing Saga.
Oh my gosh.
Is dropping. I don't know too much about this. I saw the gameplay, of course, on it. Good for them that it's getting a remake, and it's coming to the PS4. So we'll see. And then Romantic Saga 3 is. And then Saga Scarlet Grace has never been in America, is also coming to America now. Mm-hmm. So it'll be on PS4, Steam, iOS, and Android. So that, I feel, really stretches the legs, enables some flexibility to really enjoy the game. So good for them. Let's just see how the game, you know, plays. Outrider got announced. It's a 1-3 player co-op shooter from Gears of War Judgment developers. It's a journey, according to Square, across a dark and desperate sci-fi world for a mysterious signal. and they'll announce more towards the end of the year. Coming on Xbox, PS4, and PC. Oninaki is another RPG dropping on the 22nd of August. War of the Visions is a game.
Is that, you guys heard of, JD said a little while ago that he doesn't know fall games. We're going to switch this over. Yes. So we got the trailer right below me. Final Fantasy Brave Exvius.
You had it prepped.
Oh, I had a prep ready to go.
Why anyway.
Final Fantasy Brave Exvius, War of the Vision. So JD, if you don't mind.
Take the wheel.
So FFBE2 is going to be a mobile game that's coming out. It's got the code name FFBE2. It's Final Fantasy Brave Exvius, War of the Visions. So the trailer below me, the art style is that of Final Fantasy Tactics. You could say Advance as well, since they fall into the same category. It has a very much like a Game of Thrones concept of houses and fractions. It's going back to basics when it's so Brave Exvius is your character is a class. You get Cloud from Final Fantasy VII. He's a warrior. You can't do anything with that. You can just gear him completely different. And the Brave Exvius War of the Visions now. It's a mobile game that's entirely based around the Final Fantasy Tactics mindset or the gameplay aspects. There is a game out that's called The Alchemist Code, which is available to download right now, both global and Japanese. And that's also a tactics-based game. And the overlay is really it's clean. If you're not familiar with mobile games, it's a gacha mobile game where you pull for characters. You can spend in-game currency. You could spend real money. There's some pay-to-win. There's many different terms when it comes to mobile games, but specifically for War of the Visions, it's going to be a tactics-based game. I'm pretty sure that somewhere in the trailer, in the first part, it shows the first level. You know when you're playing as Ramza and Delita and you're in the schoolhouse and they're like, all right, we need to get out to do our first mission, and you're chucking rocks at the back of your homie's head to level up? Da, 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 da. I did it!
Let's begin the battle.
I'm prepared for the next battle.
They get pumped when they level.
Dude, they did. Da, da, da.
Yes!
Dude, Rob is like, oh. I'm trying to fight Rygar. So Final Fantasy, so real quick, Farmatron, great question. Final Fantasy Brave Exvius 2, War of the Visions does not have a release date yet. It's going to be released in the Japanese version first, which I will absolutely doing the best I can to push out content for, as well as streaming it as much as I can without knowing. But if you look at the gameplay below me, it's very reminiscent of Tactics. Again, this is the first stage that looks just like the first stage. It has two confirmed characters from the Brave Exvius world. One's from 14. So in the trailer, they discuss...
Oh,
yes. So they're discussing that the first... While the game is getting released, they're doing a Shadowbringers crossover, which is why you see Ishtola, which we'll go into Final Fantasy 14 for sure. But they have a lot of different assets for Final Fantasy Brave Exvius. And from what I understand from the trailer, they're really trying to focus on making War of the Visions its own game and not trying to take too many things from Brave Exvius. Though the fact that Ayaka and... I must forget her name wrong. I call her Quistis. Because she comes with a dual wield magic attack. They have two characters already confirmed that were Medina. Thank you, Sienna. Medina. She.
Minfilia?
We have two characters that were in Brave Exvius that are now in War of the Visions. So that means that, you know, the parallel's there. So not only do they share the same title. Hey, look, Clay's video's loading up too. So I think a big thing with War of the Visions. Is going to be, it's a tactics game that's coming out, it feels like the Alchemist Code, it looks like it. There's house fractions, there's going to be guild wars, there's going to be PvP, it's going to be multiplayer, which has been missing from Final Fantasy Brave Exvius. A lot of content, the game has been out for 3 years. I'm really, really looking forward to this game. Clay Kizolt, a great friend, has already made a video kind of dissecting the trailer that we just watched, kind of little by little by little by little. So definitely looking forward to when that comes out, because being a fan and a streamer of Brave Exvius and having a second one come out that's based on a tactics game, you're talking about houses, you're talking about wars, the storyline's going to be pivotal. Which side do you go with? I mean, we're the western hemisphere is riding off the high of Game of Thrones, or low depending on who you are. We're running this Game of Thrones high of fractions and PvP and interaction and exclusive and interconnecting. So, like, it's just a lot of these keywords that I'm saying are just making me super hyped for it. So, Final Fantasy Brave Exvius 2, War of the Visions. I can't stop saying 14. War of the Visions is going to be a great mobile game coming out. Super excited for it. JP is going to come out first, followed by the global, so I will definitely be playing the Japanese version of that.
Yeah. What's up, Gildor?
Oh, I keep saying factions. I'm sorry.
You did. You said
factions. Oh, my bad.
I was like, let him talk.
Let me do my thing. I'm sorry. What's up, Gildor? Thanks, Major.
So that's actually kind of interesting. I really like the concept of how they were doing the tactics and whatnot on it. Obviously, my shitty ass phone, I need a new one. So, Tom, it's cracked.
Listen, man. listen. I'm gonna put you on mobile games yet. The next podcast we do, y'all. I love me some Last Claudia. I love me some FFBE2. My dog Cloud got me.
Yeah.
Probably not. We'll
see. Crystal Chronicles Remastered is out this winter, so Troy can get all salty again.
That's also mobile too, man. Yeah, I'm gonna. Yeah, you know what? I am gonna stay out of the miasma and die out there. Have fun having another damage dealer.
Deal with it.
Deal with it. Also, also, my family doesn't like your family, so suck it. Blacksmithing is going out.
Inside jokes. Inside jokes.
Inside joke,
that
guys.
Aside, I think that'd probably be a good game for us to stream. It's coming out this winter. Out this winter. so for Switch, PS4, and mobile games, let's do PS4, just so that way we can stream it easier. Last Remnant is available as of, I think, what, yesterday?
Last Remnant's a PS2? PS3?
Yeah, it's available on the Switch.
That's cool. I like the crossover platforms. I like that.
Yeah. Kingdom Hearts is getting a DLC called Remind.
Remind me not to download it.
More like never mind. Anyway.
So... What's that Will Smith meme? It's rewind time.
It's rewind.
He was part of the
5 ways to control time.
Will Smith was part of the YouTube rewind, and he's like, it was a terrible video because PewDiePie couldn't be in it.
So, hold on, real quick. Kildor said something. Kildor, you should probably play Final Fantasy 14 if you want some Final Fantasy 6 love. There's all kinds of Final Fantasy 6 love in 14. Just gonna say.
Oh, Clay, yeah. I've talked about this in great lengths on stream. Dude, Kingdom Hearts. I watched the missus beat Kingdom Hearts 3. I'm not mad. I'm just angry and disappointed.
Yeah. Hey, yeah, Clay, we got to talk about it. Next time we get together, we'll discuss it, have a couple beers.
Have a couple beers, put you in a straitjacket.
Tell the doctor that you're at the end of the day, there's a discussion to be had.
Ain't no discussion. I'm just kidding.
Hey, come on now. Kildor, know who you are. Don't worry about it. So let's talk about the elephant in the room here. The elephant on the screen, in fact. Final Fantasy VII. Let's talk first about the way that they announced the ATB is still in the game, which I'm impressed with. What they were saying as far as to, like, you know, to be tactical, you're gonna need ATB.
I thought I was taking BCAs when he said that shit. I was like, should I be taking this ATB or what? Like, do I need it?
Yeah. That's definitely something that's interesting. I'm always a fan of new stuff, new ways to tackle objects. Like, that's how the stealth genre was created in the first fucking place. So I love seeing that stuff happen and how these developers come together and go, hey, we want to please both parties. It is going to be released as episodes, man. But you know what? From what I hear, it's going to be pretty long episodes. It's 2 discs, Blu-ray, and
that's 50 gigs.
Both full. So, no, you're not going to spend 30 hours in Midgard.
What do you mean? That's it? Those are rookie numbers. You need to pump those up, bro. I'm looking at every crack and detail inside of Cloud and Midgard.
I can imagine this stream. You're going to have the most boring stream because you're going to be like, all right, I'm going to check this proton, or not this proton, this atom.
I'm going to have to turn off the camera because I'm going to be sweating the whole time, man. You ever seen a grown-ass, sweaty gamer with tattoos? The way I'm putting that story doesn't sound too well. Okay.
Grown-ass, sweaty gamer.
All right, dude. So, I wonder, okay, so devil's advocate. Obviously, I love the game. I love it. I love the game. Visually, it's good. I'm okay with the wait I'm okay with waiting so long for the game to come out. I really am. I want them to do it right the first time. We might never get an opportunity like this, and we might never see something like this again. However, if it pays out well, then phenomenal. We might see an 8. We might see a 9. We might see a tactics.
I'd be okay without a 9. I'd be okay with the tactics. I know Kildor would be good with a 6.
Let me ask you a question. So, first thing outside the game, do you think this first class edition is too expensive?
he says as he's buying it. Do you think your purchase has been completed?
So I had talked again. I was watching Clay Kizilt's stream, watching the chat get hype. I actually purchased the deluxe edition. I have the Advent Children figure that you got me. And as much as I would love to use...
Which is a higher quality than that action figure, by the way. I just want to point out.
As much as I want to ride the ship that I'm, you know, a Cloud shill, and Cloud is my absolute being, and I love everything about him, I don't need that. The other thing, the only two things that you're missing out on are three, Bike Cloud and Carbuncle. And I'd rather use that money to invest back into my stream or to invest into other streamers or... other organization. So
I feel there's a novelty associated with that. What's going on? I think you should get it. That's my opinion.
Well, we could chat offline, but I've already put down for the deluxe. So gameplay wise, obviously we got to see some action from Barrett. We got to see the seamless transition from Cloud fighting up top on a tower to Barrett shooting. We got to see Cloud attack an enemy and then Tifa come up and combo. I'm glad they showed off how it looked, because it wasn't like Tifa comboed in the air, Cloud jumped, slash, and then Tifa jumped. It literally showed Tifa uppercutting, but because Cloud was hitting at the exact same time, the enemy didn't go up. The combat looked amazing. The fact that you got to see where the materia was equipped at, a big thing too, a big thing too about the, again, attention to detail. Cloud's Buster Sword, before we started streaming, Cloud's Buster Sword, his default weapon only holds two slots. So I wonder, and then JD made a reference that I never paid attention to it in the trailer, but I guess in one of the trailers it shows him equipped with the Rune Blade.
Yeah, when he's fighting what's that guy called that knocks him off the bridge? I forget his name.
Oh my gosh. The one where he gets separated from Tifa.
He's flying up, which is really cool.
Weapon Buster. It's something Buster.
Which is also really cool to see. Air Buster. Which is always cool to see is how they reimagine that stuff. By the way, Kilgore, thanks for your investment, of course.
Shout out to Kilgore, man, for the 4 months in a row, man. Appreciate that.
There's a action figure for. Obviously, Farmatron and I have action figures for. We've got Dragon Ball characters. It's the next caliber up, but it's not all that high quality. It's not terrible quality. It's good quality, but it's not like amazing, perfect, whatever. The seeing the Airbuster and whatnot was really cool. I am disappointed with the gameplay, though. One major facet actually really bothers me about that game. That I'm just sort of like. This is disappointing. Vincent's not there.
Oh god, I was waiting on bated breath, dude. Well, I was about to snap.
I'm just
Where waiting. Is the guy? Original Turk.
But at the same time, I do, speaking of Turks, want to see the Turks, but I also want to see Cid. Because you know, I'm on my Dragoon hype for a minute. So I want to see how he has a proper jump, you know? Like they're a good looking ass John, you know what I'm saying? Like, put that in Final Fantasy 14.
Dude, RNA had it in 15.
She did.
And it worked out well. I don't know what it looks like indoors. I don't know how Baby Girl can touch the galaxy like that.
Yeah, that's Bay right there, for sure. But, that actually brings up another question that another thing that I'm actually interested in is seeing how they do a crossover, because they're going to do one with Final Fantasy VII. It's going to be next year, which means you got a little more time, but you got to hurry up and catch up, man. Yeah.
I mean, well, before we get into 14, we're not just sliding past 7. Yeah. So the gameplay was amazing. The materia, Tifa looked awesome.
ATB is great because it pleases both audiences.
Yes, exactly.
It's my main point.
No. It, for the combat wise, you again, Final Fantasy 15 felt. Okay, Kingdom Hearts 3, I'm a little distant towards, specifically because it felt like I was floating the entire time. It wasn't the constant mashing, which is that what's going to happen in Final Fantasy 7. That's not what I'm saying. It's the floaty. Yeah. And Kingdom Hearts 2 nailed it. It was the perfect amount of foot foot on ground, foot in air. Final Fantasy VII has that. Cloud's this super strong character, but isn't meant to be floating through the air. Now, who knows what happens if you fight Sephiroth, or what happens when you fight Genova Afterbirth, or what happens when you fight... I don't know. I'm also looking forward to some of the flashback scenes.
That's true. But we're also looking at a situation where the story's altered. Cloud did not see Sephiroth that quickly in Midgar. So we can only imagine what's going on as far as to the changes that they made. They've already mentioned that they're making changes, so, you know, whatever. I mean, even from what I'm looking at on the gameplay here, when they show the train scene, we're not playing that game where we're getting knocked off the train or where we have to jump off the train and stuff like that. But we are getting cool things like Don Cornelio's freaking monster and stuff. Obviously, we're going to get Cloud and Drag. We're going to get...
I am saying this right now on this podcast in front of JD. If we can get a confirmed date, the day that I play that game and I go to Don Cornelio, I will cross-dress on stream. 100%. I will get a blonde wig. I will get a blonde wig and I will wear a purple dress on stream.
Farmer-chan, why are you trying to get, like, shot, man?
Zach is better than Cloud? Okay, listen, first
Zach
off.
Zach is a good character.
You spelled his name wrong, so... Rookie.
Who's
that, Zack and Dexter?
Zack and Dexter.
Oh, man. Anyway, I would love to... We're probably going to tackle Final Fantasy VII a bit more during our next podcast, which is going to be Sunday. This is kind of like an E3 recap one, but... Clicks videos come back up. But again, just going... I am... March 3rd seems like the perfect amount of time. Two discs that are Blu-rays, that's 50 gigs. That's at maximum 50 gigs each. I wonder how far it's going to go. They're not going to take, you know, every single flaw, every single... Hopefully they take everything that's well about the game and translate it well to the 7 remake. Because this is a testament, man. Personally, I don't think Kingdom Hearts 3 came through for me. So this game, for being in production as long as it has, I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, I don't think, based on what they're saying, like, I was really worried at first. I don't think they can really fail. I'm calling it right now. I could be wrong, but I don't think they're going to fail at this game. It's going to be a good game. And to answer Major Role's question, also, what's the deal with Cloud, Aerith Ghost scene? I don't remember that in the original game. What specifically?
So there's a scene. All right,
where she grabs his arm.
She says, yeah, Cloud, help me.
Creative liberties, man. That never happened initially. So they're obviously modifying the story a little bit. For all we know, if I'm being honest, for all we know, they could be legit doing a Advent Children added into it. Like, I could be taking some
maybe, yeah, yeah.
Adding that in there, like post Sephiroth's death, you're dealing with that shit. Who knows? That could be DLC.
A part of me just feels like they're trying to. So when you we can unpack this, but when you look back at Aerith's Aerith, there's only one huge scene where she's labeled as an ancient, and that's when she's leaving, and her surrogate mother is like, yeah, no, she's not normal, she's an ancient. That one scene was crucial, and then out of nowhere she starts developing. So I don't know, maybe these fucking Death Eaters from Harry Potter. Maybe they're gonna whisper. Maybe they're gonna do something. Maybe they're gonna do something different to be like, you know, she's the ancient, or like, I don't know. But that definitely was not in the original. Cloud and Aerith hit. She dropped the flowers. If you wanna have a date with Barrett, you got to make sure you not hit on the girl, so you can't buy a flower. And then you walk away, and then you join the rest of Avalanche, and then you guys go head out for the second mission.
That's what Barrett likes, commitment.
Commitment, yeah. Hey, what up? Oh, thanks, man. You didn't
get
one?
I got no time for these females.
Hashtag these hoes ain't loyal.
I've been with you since day one. Don't you love me?
Come on, dog. X-Cloud, X-Soldier, my dog.
Kiss me.
I think that Major Role, that's an absolute great point. That's not the original game. Just like JD said, it's going to be... liberties. Liberties are going to be bestowed. Final Fantasy VII, the original, was a long game. So they have to compact it with these 3D visuals, with these updated graphics, with these mechanics and voiceovers. So I feel like they're going to take the story and chop out the points that weren't necessarily super important. Who knows if we're going to get the climbing the iceberg scene or the mountain, the ice mountain, when you freeze and you got to shake. They better keep the fucking squatting there. It's going to be rated R because I'm pretty sure Barrett and Cloud both said shit like 3 times.
Oh, and I love that.
During the scorpion fight. Anyway.
And last point.
No, go ahead. Yeah, my bad.
I do have to say I do like it's the same voice actor from Advent Children. So I do like that he has developed his voice better. So his grunts don't sound like he's just in a studio. It sounds a little bit better. We'll have to see though. Moving on, I'm not going to talk about it too much. Final Fantasy 14 obviously is my game. A lot of shit developing. You did see the trailer, did you?
I did. I watched it. Didn't make any sense to me because they're like, we're going to...
All right, ignore all of it.
Well, Shadowbringers...
Oh, look at that beautiful specimen right there.
Shout out to Clay. Sorry, your video came up. My bad, man. Sorry, dude. I'm a rookie, so I'm trying to record better. My bad.
But I will say, without spoiling it too much, there was a big bomb dropped towards the end of the Final Fantasy 14 trailer that a lot of people just went, holy shit, which pretty much changes the entirety of the game without going into detail about it. With the new classes and the new jobs that are coming out, obviously the game drops on July, I believe, 2nd, but early access is the 29th. I'll be on early access. My brother will be on early access. We'll probably be playing it at that point and just trying to move forward in the game. And progress and whatnot. I'm probably going to hit... I've been a Dragoon main since 2.0, so I'm going to play Dragoon until 80, and I'll probably double back Machinist up because Machinist looks fucking awesome. And then drop back. I didn't really get your take as far... Because I sent you the classes, or the... What's it called? And outside the bomb-ass music... I wanted to know what you thought about the ninja skills because they're doing a lot of shit for ninja too.
All right, so I definitely want to try a dancer, only because that's my spirit animal, right? I want to be a dancer. hashtag joking, but I really want to play support, and you know that. Honestly, looking over the ninja, so the katon, the flame ball looks dope as hell. It's upgraded, but I think the hypest thing is the kagebushin, the duel. So. Where am I? Okay, if I'm spoiling this for you, I don't care because I'm getting used to the Final Fantasy 14 story. So a certain character was overtaken by the Ashians, and we just got him back. That was like...
You did the 50 thing already.
Yeah, yeah. I'm...
You... Son of a bitch.
Dude, you... I'm
without me?
I'm fine.
I literally just did it with Eric... today.
first time?
Yeah, it was the first time. Yeah. He's tanking.
You know what sucks, dude? Is I hated it. I love the Final Fantasy 14 community, but you guys are a bunch of rushing assholes. Give me two fucking seconds. Dude, no one wants to do it, man. I'm like, hey guys, rookie here. Immediately everyone's like, I hate this stage. This stage sucks. And then they don't tell me they're running past everything. I'm fighting. I turn my camera back around. I'm like, why am I getting hit so... Oh, that's why. My team's gone. I got so livid. I don't know what level it is. I still don't know because it happened so fast. I just had to sit there and let it happen to me. I'm running as a ninja, like the slowest, sluggish runner. I don't know why I'm running so slow. I get to a platform. Everyone's pressing the button, but I'm like, if I press the button, I'm going to get interrupted. I'm not going to deal with it. I'll go down the elevator with them. Go down the elevator. Everyone is in a cutscene at the Magic Tech armor. And I'm like, what the fuck am I doing wrong? It says I can't do it. So I'm sitting there. I'm like, everyone leaves me. Everyone's gone. I'm like, oh my gosh. And I type in chat, hey guys, it won't let me get in the armor. I said it was my first time. And they're like, you stupid idiot. You have to go press the button. I'm like, what button? The one up the elevator. And they say, asshole. And I'm like, I don't know what I've done to deserve this. I clearly stated, first up, my name's Baby Girl. Help me. Anyway, dude, I was livid, dude. If I ever get speed rushed, okay, the only game I want to be speed rushed in is Diablo 2. I don't need you to. Dude, I don't need you to. I was livid, man. I will say, it would have been better to experience the storyline, and just, you know, just like with everyone, because we ran past everything. So anyway, that's where I'm at in the story, and this, like, that took me for a shock when a certain character got
stuff.
Yeah, stuff happened. I didn't know Final Fantasy XIV had that good of a storyline, man. I really didn't. So anyway. JD, keep going with the 14 trailer.
Hey, Clegg again. Hey, what's up, man? How you doing?
Clegg's back.
Anyway, with all the changes that they're making to the game, they're switching around a couple of things. DPS isn't really getting affected too much, except for Machinist. Big overhaul for Machinist. But I love it on this podcast.
I don't know how to keep a view. Anyway, keep going. I'll talk to
you. You
got to
switch
the
video, man. You gotta pop on something else. We're about to switch over to Nintendo here in a minute, anyway. But
we might have to put a pin in it. We're at 125.
Oh, god damn it.
Yeah.
All right, let me just skip Final Fantasy. We're going to talk briefly about Nintendo, okay? All right, so Nintendo. What?
You went yeah.
Nintendo, Breath of the Wild, the sequel is in development, apparently. Really quick. We'll see what's going on with that. Banjo-Kazooie and Dragon Quest's Hero are announced as two Smash Ultimate characters. I saw the trailer for both of them. I don't care about Banjo-Kazooie at all. I'm sorry. I never played the games growing up, so I'm just like, whatever. I would have preferred Master Chief, but that's me. And then Dragon Quest's Hero, or Heroes, is in it, so that's kind of cool. You get to see all the different heroes in the trailer. So obviously it's a palette swap, so you just switch the skin and that's it. Animal Crossing New Horizon for Switch is coming out, but it's in March 20th of 2020. The Switch remake of Link's Awakening will have a custom dungeon mode. Comes out on September 20th. Cadence of Hyrule, which is pretty much Guitar Hero for the Zelda soundtrack, is coming out on June 13th. that's all I can say. Dun, 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 dun. You know, like,
shred it, bro. Nice shorts.
Luigi's Mansion 3 has couch co-op and an online mode. Never played a single one, but good for them. No More Heroes 3 is in development.
Ooh,
Travis,
I like that one.
Touchdown strikes again, but he looks fucking different. So whatever. The Pokeball Plus controller can be used with Pokemon Sword and Shield.
I am excited for those, and I haven't been excited for Pokemon game in a while.
I don't know who you are anymore.
That's what I said when I looked in the mirror.
A previously untranslated Mana game is coming to Switch. The follow-up to Secret of Mana is coming to the Switch. It's going to be part of Collection of Mana. Switch Retro Collection that includes the first three games. Final Fantasy Adventure for the Game Boy, Secret of Mana for the SNES, which is a very good game, and then Trials of Mana is coming for its English language debut, so good for them. Dragon Quest XI S Definitive Edition will hit Switch on the 27th, and The Witcher 3 is coming to Switch, good for them.
Yeah, Witcher 3.
First time
TNA game
is showing up on the Switch.
The fact that you reference that as TNA makes my heart sing. I don't know why.
That's little, the only thing that makes sense to me.
Baby girl TNA action.
Resident Evil 5 and 6 are coming to Switch. Good for them. Contra Rogue Core. Me and Troy have a history of Contra.
Fucking Shattered Soldier.
And then that other one. I think we actually beat it. I put that other one as well. It was the sequel after it. I played the
dude with the braids.
Yeah, that was me. You know,
I couldn't play as him.
So it's going to be up to four players. And the Contra Anniversary Collection is available today. Didn't really talk about what's on it. Remake of Panzer Dragoon is coming to the Switch.
Meh.
I've played the first Panzer Dragoon on Sega Saturn. I owned it. It was fun.
So is anyway. Order the second one, or is it called Panzer Dragoon Order?
Panzer Dragoon is the Order, I believe, is probably...
I had no idea it was a sequel.
Yeah. Dark Crystal series is getting a tie-in tactics RPG. It's got claymation-style graphics. Turn off for me, yeah. But I'm sure some people like it.
It's going to be a no for me, dog.
Empire of Sin. It's a game created by John Romero of Doom and Brenda Romero, I believe, is his wife. It'll be out in spring 2020. I think one of the big things that wasn't actually mentioned here was the Vampire Masquerade that a lot of people were talking about that they said that they're super hyped for. It's
the first time I've ever heard of that term in my life.
I guess look it up because I need to watch the trailer.
Have they? There's no. I missed the Nintendo one, so there's no talks of a Odyssey 2.
No Metroid talk.
I don't know, so, man. Why does Baby Girl get pushed to the side like that?
I know, right? Come on, man. Come on, man.
You can't just keep doing. You can't just keep making remakes. Give me a new one. I need a site. I need a. Do they even make Game Boy Advance games anymore?
Do they make what?
I need a DS games. Did you? You have any information on VR? I actually missed that too.
I'd have to get back to you later on.
I'll look it up. I just
the cliff notes.
I like I said, I'm such a fan of psychological first person horrors. The last two games that I played on VR, I'm currently still playing one. And it's funny you brought up the Legion. It's because I'm playing the game called The Exorcist Legion VR, and it's an amazing game. I'm a masochist, man. I genuinely enjoy being put into an uncomfortable situation where I'm supposed to be getting scared. Like I want to go do. I want to go.
You didn't get Five Nights?
So no, I had no idea that Five Nights was all of the games. I thought Five Nights VR was the first game, but if you buy, it's like $30. But if you buy Five Nights at Freddy's VR, you get every single game revamped to VR.
Yeah.
So that might be something. My friends let me hold on to his HTC Vive. Kildar, man, thanks for the 100 Pog Champs, man. Appreciate that. Anyway, dude, I'm such a big fan of horror. If you anyone out there have first-person psychological horrors while I wait for Visage 2 or Chapter 2, please let me know in the comments below. JD, you have any closing remarks, man? We've been pushing about a hour 30 right now.
Please keep watching. That's all I've got.
Yeah.
Outside of that, I think my favorite conference was Square. Not trying to be biased on it. I just think they had the most content that I was interested in. And I'd say my favorite game for it, as far as if we're talking about new announcements, let me go back real quick.
So we didn't chat about it too much. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead. I thought you were going to think about it. My bad.
Hold on. I closed it.
So real quick, I think I'm going to take away Square Enix personally, just because I'm incredibly biased. I think the best conference by presentation wise was Microsoft. I love Xbox more than I like PS4. If it's out for both consoles, I'll get it for Xbox. But if it's a Sony exclusive, definitely I'll pick it up. Shout outs to Bloodborne 2. Yep, take it easy, Kildor. But Microsoft had the best event. And then the one game that I'm waiting for, it might be as surprising, is Ori and the Will of the Wisps. I rented Ori and the Blind Forest on Gamefly. And I listen to the OST frequently, both doing homework and streaming. I love the gameplay. I love the it was like Castlevania. It was Metroidvania. There was attacking. There was no text. There's no text. You interpret the story based on sounds, emotions, and like character, like how they interact with each other. So Ori and the Will of the Wisps is the game. The most I didn't know was coming. Didn't pay attention to it. So the game I'm most excited for is that.
Yeah, I'd say probably being a fucking loser than I am, I'd say Breakpoint. Even though it wasn't announced at E3. I'm sorry, man. I'm really into just sort of squad-based shooters, because I like being able to work as a team to accomplish a goal as opposed to being by myself. Final Fantasy VII was very good, and I was pleasantly surprised. I think Square literally was like a 12-year-old discovering their body. They blew their load so quick it wasn't even real. Like, the second it started, let's check out fucking Final Fantasy! And then that was kind of it.
Yeah, they should have went the other way just to build. They really should have, but they wanted to get that new game continue remake.
Yeah, I'm very impressed by what they're doing. And it's one of those things where they have such an advantage, whether they know it or not, to be able to go, now we're going to go, this game is going to, you know, take the same things that you know and love. Now we're going to make it sick. Like, what we're looking at right here, he's snatching up Cloud. The ability that Barrett's able to blow him off of him, it's even small shit like that, people fucking love that stuff. Love that stuff. You're going to be able to fight that monster soon in 14, by the way. But, you know, we'll get there.
I missed the 15 collab, but whatever.
I don't think you missed it. I think it's still on. I could be wrong.
I've been grinding that like crazy, man. Every Sunday. And JD, I know we got points, but we're past hour and a half.
Okay.
Yeah, dude. Sorry, JD. All right, guys. This is gonna get uploaded to YouTube here tomorrow. Hopefully, the stream part worked. It's very difficult for both of us to watch a stream, chit chat with everyone. But definitely on Q&As. Maybe on the days where we're just gonna, you know, maybe have a chit chat with you guys. Definitely hit the follow button. Subscribe to the channel if you guys want to see myself play more video games. JD will be here with me either on YouTube, or maybe this is a thing we do. We start streaming this. But JD, you want to give a plug for yourself? Any shout outs?
Yeah, read below. That's it.
All right, nerds. We will see you guys on Sunday for our next podcast, where we'll go to our normal fluctuation of how we do things. So, nerds, I hope you guys have a great rest of your night. Hit that follow button, subscribe if you guys want to see and hear more. We will see you later. High five. Other way. You would do it. Wait, again.
Well, one, two. This is stupid.